Hello and best wishes everyone, and happy birthday, Mary and Jean, begins this batch of dedications. This is a record for you all from the people who sent the messages down by the lazy river with the Osmonds.
What are you doing tonight? You got no place to go.
1976. Britain seems half asleep.
No, it was awful. The main colours were orange, brown, and mustard.
People weren't as sussed as what they are today. People weren't as well travelled, and we were still stuck in this little hole, you know, as British people, I thought. You think of the 70s as being, you know, the modern times, but it was very, very backward, you know, and people's attitudes were very backward.
There was one or two TV channels. Everything seemed to end at 11. There was no jobs, there was no future. There was a sense in those early years of boredom.
You don't remember your youth as being populated by these guys who looked like the worst kind of bureaucrat from 1952. Those are the people who still ran the country.
Welcome to Boring Britain. A young generation has been locked out. But in a small pocket of the London music scene, something is stirring. The UK is about to be rudely awoken.
Smash, get smashed.
Main reason.
Dirty bastard.
Stop. Again.
You dirty fucker.
What a clever boy.
What a
kidding, Mr. Hitler, if you think old England's done.
In the scorching summer of 1976, the Sex Pistols, the Clash and the Damned were beginning to ignite. As word gradually spread through the country, London was becoming a place of pilgrimage for the curious few.
There was already this feeling that something was going on in London. There'd been a couple of reviews of the Sex Pistols in the music papers, and we thought, hello, this sounds good. And then you saw this photo of, like, Rotten just looking incredible, mean and nasty. Finally, someone who's, like, looking different and challenging. Looking like we felt. I think trying to get a punk band together in Torquay at that time was never going to happen.
I was always escaping the suburbs and gravitating towards the centre of London. If you're brought up in the suburbs with all that ultra-conservatism that goes on there, then there's a lot to kick back against.
I thought London was central to everything, really. I mean, there wasn't a music scene in Woking. Just meeting sort of people my own age represented a place where you could be yourself. At that time, we were playing social clubs to disinterested punters, really, who really just wanted the bingo. And maybe we'd have a bit of a dance towards the end of the night when they're pissed enough.
I got no reason, it's all too much. You'll always find me. Out to lunch. We're at lunch.
We read this review in the NME and the Pistols, and we all got to go and see this band. And so we all travelled up and went to this all-nighter where we took speed as well for the first time. The effect of the pills and seeing this band was like, wow, this is it. This is our time, you know.
Oh, we're so brilliant, oh, we're so brilliant.
It was such a closed, small scene. I mean, maybe there's 500 people in the whole of England, maybe, who knew about it. It's very small. I mean, you knew the faces you saw every week.
What Johnny Rotten and Joe Strummer, etc., were expressing was so absolutely instantly recognised right across the land. there was this punk rock explosion.
News of the small scene that had been incubating in the heart of the capital was slowly spreading.
You know, we were aware of a core of punk bands and
stood in the minds of the converted few. But all that was about to change.
They are punk rockers. The new craze, they tell me.
Well, there's a conservative.
You see, they are as drunk as I am.
He was the institution, and we were not.
They're a group called the Sex...
Bill Grundy was the host of a pre-Watershed news programme called The Today Show, on which the Sex Pistols were a last-minute booking.
They're heroes, not the nice, clean Rolling Stones company.
Queen were going to do it and pulled out at the last minute, so there we were, short notice, and Bill Grundy didn't want to interview us. I didn't know, though, was that Steve had found a bottle of Blue Nun and gone in another room and drunk the lot.
Suddenly, millions of viewers sitting down to their early evening TV dinners were confronted by something a little bit unexpected.
What about you girls behind?
You know, we didn't have a clue what was going to happen. Bill Grundy was just so contemptuous of them.
Which what?
Nothing, a rude word. Next question.
No, no. What was the rude word?
Shit.
There he is. He's the one goading us into it. No, he definitely had an eye on the young ladies in the bin liners.
Always wanted to meet you.
Did you really? Yeah. We'll meet afterwards, shall we?
You dirty son.
Yeah. I mean, I've been... Oh, I've always wanted to meet you. Not really.
So he had a real attitude on... He picked the wrong guys, and then halfway through the interview, Steve's bottle of Blue Nun kicks in. You know, it was a recipe for disaster.
Go on, you've got another 5 seconds. Say something outrageous.
You dirty bastard.
Go on, again.
You dirty fucker.
What a clever boy.
What a fucking rotter.
Well, that's it for tonight.
Swearing on primetime television just didn't happen in 1976.
I mean, the reaction the next day in the newspapers was just like... What? The filth and the fury, and it was like exclamation mark, front pages.
Far from reveling in the scandal, Sex Pistols manager Malcolm McLaren was initially very worried.
Malcolm was ghostly white, like, you've ruined everything I've been working for. You've just destroyed a year's worth of work, you know, by swearing on television. Next morning, he saw all the front pages and realised it was a good idea.
The next day, punk rock was a national phenomenon.
I am an anti-Christ. I am an anarchist. Don't know what I...
Fresh from their Grundy Show appearance, the Sex Pistols embarked on the Anarchy in the UK tour with The Damned and The Clash. But they quickly discovered that being the centre of national attention wasn't necessarily a good thing.
I remember it felt great on the Sex Pistols' first tour that was no tour. We had a crate of beer and I was drunk. But the next day, that's like, no, that's just not right. Why are we banned?
Relationship with God and a right way with God in his world.
This protest to make Wales know, to let the people of this town know that we do protest.
On the rare occasion a town council allowed the Pistols to play, they were met with a mixture of local protesters and the odd curiosity seeker who managed to break through the picket line.
Well, it's lowering the standard of our people in Gaffilly. But see, I think it's degrading and disgusting for our children to hear and see such things.
How do you feel about the crowd opposite?
They're entitled to do what they want.
It was strange to be part of something where venues were being withdrawn, where you can't play, you know, you're being censored. You know, you felt persecuted. Lines were drawn, you know, and you chose what side you were on.
How do you react to the reputation that your group is the most revolting in the country?
Look, our group is creating a generation gap for the first time in 5 years in this country, and a lot of people are being genuinely threatened by it. We ain't even being allowed to play.
There was so much going on. There was so much vicious hatred towards us because we were doing something completely new. We looked like nothing that most people had ever seen.
I tried so hard to be nice.
It taught me that the British are by nature very conservative.
Almost overnight, punk had become public enemy number one.
Punk rock has become almost a battle cry in British society. For many people, it's a bigger threat to our way of life than Russian communism or hyperinflation.
What I'm concerned about is the manner in which certain groups behave on stage.
And now they're bringing out these freak punk rock groups. We're not going to have this sort of punk rock again.
It's all wrong.
But for much of Britain's youth, punk meant something else entirely.
I want you to do something for me. Because look at me now, I'm nothing.
That's what punk is.
Punk was our time. This was our music and our generation. There was a real sense of these people are going to destroy civilization.
If we get beat up for it, that's bloody hard luck, you know. We're never going to back down. Into the future,
Sasuke! It didn't matter about class, but a lot of it was largely working class. But it mattered about what your ideas were like.
People abandon us, that they're saying that I'm vile and obscene. Do I look vile and obscene?
People looked on in horror because they just didn't understand what it was that we were. But what we really were was a byproduct of what was happening, and we threw it back at them. And actually, it was quite a laugh.
I think punk was a time when all the freaks, the misfits, and the outlaws had their moment in the sun.
As 76 gave way to 77, punk's clarion call had been sounded. A new generation was sick of waiting for its turn.
There was still this whole idea that you could only advance if you put in the years. And that was across the board. Industry, art, commerce.
A new do-it-yourself spirit was beginning to take root.
Punk was about being an active participant rather than just being a passive consumer. It made you think, well, I can do that. So the next question is, why the hell don't you do it?
Are you a singer?
Yeah.
Have you sung before?
Not on stage, no.
Suddenly, the spotlight belonged to anybody who wanted it.
With very little resources, we were very resourceful.
What did you sing?
The Lord's Prayer via Twist and Shout, Knocking on Heaven's Door, and a bit of Deutschland, Deutschland, Uber Alley.
There is a way in, so long as you're persistent and aggressive and beat the hell out of them.
The whole idea that you needed someone's permission to do these things was destroyed. People were starting record labels, people were starting magazines.
We thought we had something to offer. There was a climate
for things to be radically shaken up.
But punk, but woke everybody up. They said, well, we don't have to ask anybody else's permission.
In January of 1977, a young band from Manchester called the Buzzcocks decided to release an EP themselves.
We worked out that for £500 we could press 1,000 singles and have a picture sleeve. And we decided to do an EP because people brought out EPs. The Beatles had loads of EPs and things. And so it was good because you had four songs on. You just have a single, you just got two sides. And we went in and we did four songs. I suppose we released our own record because it was just the easiest way of doing it.
And went into the college and put it on and like watched people's expressions of this and went, what the hell is this? And I still do think it's just one of the most tremendous records ever made.
You know, before that, it had been sort of aging hippies giving you the impression that really you shouldn't go out and play a guitar unless you've been at it for 30 years.
As far as punk was concerned, rock and roll had spent two decades growing ever more pompous. Punk's mission was to simply start all over again.
You know, we started referring to the bigger bands as the dinosaurs, rejecting the past, you know what I mean? The
big was a lady. Rod Stewart and people like that were getting to look sillier and sillier as the years went on. They just looked like Louis the 14th. And someone had to cut their head off.
Nothing to do with them anymore when like Rod Stewart gets up there and starts going on with his string orchestra. It's not what you feel like, so you've got to have some music what you feel like, otherwise you go balmy, don't you?
The Clash's song 1977 captured this desire to wipe the slate clean. But the Year Zero mantra hid a contradiction. Punk defined itself as the future of music, but equally championed a return to rock and roll's past. Three chords, 3-minute songs, played loud and fast.
It was more about an idea, 1977, rather than to be taken literally. I loved the Beatles, but I loved also the Rolling Stones and the Kinks. The line of rock and roll that goes right back to Elvis. When Elvis first came out, that was like nothing they'd seen before. And then when the Pistols came out, it was like nothing you'd ever seen before in the same way.
A lot of us, I mean, if anything like me, I still had Deep Purple albums. People do forget when they look back. We weren't from outer space.
Everybody liked these people, really. I never met anybody that didn't like the Stones. If you don't like the Stones, what are you doing in rock? What are you doing in a rock and roll band?
We weren't consciously lying about the rejections part, but it was important to define what punk was about. To actually start differentiating in a way that gave punk its identity to the sort of wider public.
To be a punk in 1977 was to set yourself in opposition to society in any way possible.
One of the things I had made for me at the time was this rapist mask. I used to wear this out in clubs all the time, actually. It was a great look.
I got a pair of leather trousers and I wore them for 6 months without taking them off. I would end up dyeing things in bathtubs. I'd dye one side of a shirt pink, or it was supposed to be red, but it came out pink, and the other side yellow and wear it, you know.
It was kind of wearing stuff that used to arrive in brown paper envelopes on the street, not just wearing it in the privacy of your bedroom or your dungeon. And the effect was fabulous, and the girls looked great in it.
The dog collar, what an amazing accessory. Okay, you give us nothing. We've got no jobs, we've got nowhere to go, we can't afford to buy clothes, so we're just going to wear these fucked up old tights. And what's more, we're going to look great while we do it.
He's like, you know, fuck you, we can wear what we like. I know this might upset you. Who gives a, you know, who gives a damn, really?
But notoriety came at a price. Now that punk was a matter of national controversy, many of the pubs that had nurtured the pub rock scene only a year earlier had shut their doors.
I mean, in those days, you couldn't go in the pubs, man. You couldn't go in clubs. You know, they were reluctant to put punk bands on because they didn't want that type in there.
Punk needed a home, a place where it could truly express itself.
It was in the middle of Covent Garden. It was like the surface of the moon. And the only people that you saw were punks and opera goers. To me, it's central. To me, that's the heart of it. The Roxy was the heart of it.
The Roxy, in all ways, was the most important pilgrimage you could make. The whole essence to the place was punk.
We're tucking into corners, finding ways to fill the vacuum. And though our mouths are dry, we talk in hope to hear on something new.
The place held officially, I think, 160. We had maybe 360 in there. So it's mayhem but fun. We were getting phone calls from bands. Are you a punk band? They say, yeah. Where are you from? Sheffield. Fine, you're playing next Thursday. And it was as simple as that.
You see those kids jumping up and down. It wasn't about, you know, getting hurt or having fights. No one had done that before. No, there'd never been that seething mass of frustration and anger.
The Roxy was where many of punk's new set of manners were given space to evolve. Why nod when you could pogo? Why cheer when you could hurl an arc of phlegm?
There's no option but to accept the fact people are going to gob on you. It almost became the defining kind of sign that this isn't the way things were before.
It all began with the Damned's Rat Scabies.
I was watching the Pistols and Jonesy was gobbing all over the stage and he fucking gobbed at me. And I gobbed back. The audience just saw it as a great leveller.
What would have been unthinkable a year earlier was now the norm. Gobbing was the new applause.
I remember one night I was singing and there was this double-headed spit coming at me and I was trying to get out of the way this way and I could still see it and I could try to go that way and I could still, by the time I didn't know which way to go and then it's the most revolting thing.
If they didn't spit at you, it means they didn't like you.
Bored out of our heads, bored out of our minds.
Every new movement needs somewhere where you can all gather. You know, the Roxy was that place, the place where it all fermented, you know, and started happening.
But despite having found a common cause and a place to call home, the punk scene in 77 was far from being a happy family.
Within the movement, there was lots of different tribes, but that made for a healthy competition, you know, and that's what was special about the scene, is you had all these different camps trying to one-up each other.
My band's better than your band. Your shit. We're the business. You know what I mean? It wasn't like some big commune of people working together for the greater good. God forbid.
Punks didn't like each other. No camaraderie whatsoever. At all. None. It was all competitive.
All these bands of people I'd known, mates, were all incredibly oppositional. And it was really jealousy that was driving it. They wanted to outdo the Pistols. So constantly fighting that. So punk wasn't a unified movement. It was a bunch of really jealous people trying to outdo each other.
But although this scene appeared fearless and free, a young band from Woking would show that punk was already becoming something of an exclusive club.
I mean, the genre band playing the same gigs as punk bands and they had the same energy in their music. You know, turning up in suits and all that, it was seen as a bit sort of like a bit silly.
I don't know why, but we'd always dress the same on stage. And I've made everyone go to Burton's and get suits. I'm only laughing because some of them are really atrocious as well. We've like split-level loons and satin jackets, but that's another story, folks. You know, yeah, it was to do that, to stand out, to be different from everyone else, you know, when everyone else was covered in safety pins and all that shite.
To take the piss out of them for tuning up, which Paul Weller hated.
Used to get a lot of flack for that, because they thought it was kind of too muso.
The Clash and the Pistols, they seemed like a, you know, to me like a sort of upper middle class kind of Kensington Market kind of thing. Whereas with the Jam, you knew exactly where they were coming from.
I think we appealed to people who were like us, to be quite honest. I think we appealed to a lot of people from the suburbs who weren't really part of a hip London niche. And I think that was the same all over the country, really. And I think the songs I was writing, people understood because they just saw themselves in those songs, you know?
Despite appearing as outsiders to the punk scene, the Jam were most definitely inspired by it.
The Pistols, playing short, spiky songs, and I think from that experience I just went back and started kind of writing in that sort of style a little bit, you know. And it was only really listening to The Clash and reading their lyrics that I started to think about what's going on around me. And prior to that, you know, I'd just written about sort of, you know, girls.
In May 1977, the Jam appeared on Top of the Pops.
New way, they go to Jam and in this city.
But as the record industry slowly woke up to punk's commercial potential, a tension at its heart began to emerge between staying independent and gaining mass exposure.
Every record deal we signed in those days, I seen them straight away as the enemy. They'd sign us, they'd give you the right smiles and go, oh yeah, we love what you're doing. Sign on the contract, and 2 days later, it's a list of demands.
The Pistols' attitude had ensured they had already been dropped by two labels by mid-1977. Punk and the record industry were not the easiest of bedfellows.
Wouldn't it be nice if you wrote a song about this, that, or the other? Would it be? Yeah, it were. It might be nice, but this is what I'm doing. This is what I was paid to do.
But when The Clash signed to CBS, punk found itself at a crossroads. Could they have their cake and eat it too?
I can remember serious debate within The Clash about if they should sign for CBS, if it was important to get the message out to as wide an audience as possible, or if you should do it on an independent label and risk not, you know, risk that 14-year-old in Newcastle or Glasgow never getting the message.
I mean, I said punk died the day The Clash signed at CBS. It was just that I felt that they would have made such a massive statement if they'd have made their own records for their own independent record label.
Yeah, it's all a business.
Doesn't that shock you that you wanted to destroy it and now it still is a business?
Yeah, but we signed up with them. We weren't going to go into a no-hippie thing where, like, you stay in one corner of the world and no-one ever hears about you. And if you want to come out of that corner, you've got to deal with the real world, and that's business, you know?
In May of 77, The Clash embarked upon the White Riot Tour with the Buzzcocks, Subway Sect and the Slits. The tour would quickly cement them as the new voice of Britain's dole-bound generation.
Well, mainly it's remembered for the fact that it was like the first time that a punk had played in a big place.
It was like a bunch of crazy kids all on, you know, holiday together, like on a Butlins. It was like, you know, we're all going on a summer holiday type thing. And me and Mick Jones were going out together and breaking up on and off throughout the tour, so it's all very dramatic.
The first night of the White Riot Tour at the Rainbow in Finsbury Park, it's just chaos. There's the most scary looking mean guys walking around in nothing else other than DMs, wife fronts and an old overcoat. And they're at the bus stop outside, they're not even waiting till I got in the gig. 2,000 uninitiated people turned up that night. It was the most incendiary gig and scary gig I've ever been to.
There was a few chairs smashed. Like the Teddy Boys when they ripped up the seats at Bill Haley. So that was like the same thing. It was like fairly harmless. They would disengage the seat and throw it into the orchestra pit. And we had to pay for it.
While The Clash were inciting white riots all over the UK, punk and reggae were beginning to find common cause.
It was interesting to see how my culture was turning on my white contemporaries. You know, they dug the bass lines, they dug the musical reportage aspect of the lyrics, they obviously dug the anti-establishment vibe. Didn't mind the weed either.
At punk gigs, the only thing that made it bearable for me was that DJs would play quite a lot of reggae and roots reggae and dub, which was the golden period. Phenomenal music that is just earth-shattering.
One of the key tracks played on The Clash's White Riot tour was White Man in Hammersmith Palace. By assimilating reggae into their songwriting, The Clash were beginning to reach out and expand punk's musical borders.
We couldn't do it just straight. It was because we didn't understand it. It was like we sort of understand it differently. We had to put ourselves into it.
I actually took Strummer to Hammersmith Palais the night he was inspired to write White Man in Hammersmith. The reggae lyrics was like the currency of street speak. It was like slogans, under heavy manners, cramp and paralyze them and those that worship Babylon. You know, the punks really dug that kind of lyricism.
There was a great similarity in terms of they were both rebel musics.
As Britain prepared itself for the Queen's Silver Jubilee celebrations that summer, the Sex Pistols prepared to release their second single.
Of course I wrote God Save the Queen. I wrote the rewrite. the original lyrics were unacceptable. God save the Queen, the fascist regime, it made you a moron, potential hate bomb. God save the Queen, she ain't no human being, there is no future, and England's dreaming. It came about quite easy. It was just an ongoing thought process, and finally I decided to put pen to paper. Ran to the rehearsal studio, really proud of it. Knew the band wouldn't catch on what I was saying, and somehow managed to squeak it onto vinyl.
It was the poetry of the street, the poetry of New England, the poetry against the Silver Jubilee. It was a great challenge to that ghastly kind of arse-licking of the monarchy that was going on.
To promote the single, manager Malcolm McLaren arranged for the Pistols to perform a gig on the Thames to coincide with the Queen's Own River Procession. Punk had its perfect stage, but the band were getting sick of McLaren's art school pranks.
Well, by that time, the band were on full collision course with Malcolm, particularly John. And John had a lot of power over Malcolm, but Malcolm controlled the purse strings and, you know, there was a lot of conflicts.
Ever get the feeling you've been trapped?
I was woken up that morning, told there was a boat trip. Didn't really want to go, but went anyway. Sid felt the same. Steve and Paul felt the same.
Well, I've had enough of your bullshit.
They weren't talking to each other, they weren't happy, and they didn't just have a contempt for the audience, they had a total contempt for themselves. So it was a very unhappy little trip.
The public outrage that the Pistols' appearance with Bill Grundy had unleashed was insatiable.
So there we were, and of course, before we knew it, the police boats were all around us saying, you know, stop, desist, come in.
Police going, which one's Johnny Rotten? Oh, I cannot tell a lie, Ossifer. It's him down there, isn't it? The ultimate reward. They don't even know the demon that they're chasing.
Malcolm McLaren was coming down the gangplank and shouting out, you know, the kind of stuff that Malcolm would shout, like, you know, fascist pigs and bully boys and all that.
I just heard a copper say, where's McLaren? And they gave Malcolm a hammering. They spun him around like a top and they smashed him. It kind of reflected what had happened to the whole scene. It got like really nasty, violent, played out too much too soon.
But that was the time when I thought, hang on a minute, this isn't actually fun anymore. This is a turning point.
But the real topper was the Pistols had reached number one with this alternative national anthem and then had been erased from the charts, which is a wonderful situationist and kind of surrealist achievement. To have a number one that didn't exist.
For many, the God Save the Queen boat trip had been a stunt too far. The moral provocation that the Pistols had revelled in was turning ugly.
Round about the summer of 77, Johnny Lydon was attacked and it got nasty.
There's always outside infiltrators that want to do you harm late at night.
We used to walk down the King's Road and somebody would say there's 40 Teds coming from Sloane Square. And it was a regular thing on a Saturday afternoon that kids were being beaten to pulp.
There was kind of all these different factions, tribes everywhere, you know. It was always like some sort of war going on against someone.
But there was more than youthful pride at stake. Racial tension in the UK was coming to a head. 2 months after the Jubilee, in Lewisham, South London, the anti-Nazi League would clash violently with the National Front.
Politics, particularly for young people, were coming to the fore because of the rise of the National Front. Unthinkable though it is now, at the time, it was broadly believed that people of colour could be rounded up and sent back. That's what we were fighting against. We weren't fighting, you know, to defend our multicultural society. We were like, you know, they were building the boats.
Although the gigs were exciting, not just ours, but I mean, all the gigs around that time, they were also fucking very scary. It was a very, very violent time, you know. But our music reflected that as well, I think.
Set against this backdrop, a new generation of punk bands were emerging, which were all about the working class audience.
Earlier punk scene, we were sort of almost like ponces. We were like the sort of into fashion and into that sort of aesthetic.
There was two waves which came along. The Sex Pistols audience were were art school and very snobby, very middle class, and we were working class.
If the first wave of punk was the theory, the second wave was the reality of council estate Britain. For many, the godfathers of this second wave were a band called Sham 69.
Sham 69, I think, was incredibly important. Jimmy Percy was a very complex character who had this understanding of the white council house kid.
You know, to me, when I first heard Sham 69, I thought, these are the real punks, because they're real working class kids from horrible sort of, you know, horrible areas, you know what I mean? And they've got nothing else. I mean, that's punk, you know.
Probably more pikey than fucking, you know, working class. I had that observational way of saying, he's the kid that's going to get the sack. He's the kid that's this character. And of course, those working class kids are 70% of our country. So the one thing I gave them was that belief. If I believed in me, they could believe in themselves.
But Sham 69's raw street appeal was beginning to attract certain unwanted elements to the punk scene.
The National Front or the British movement, they saw a recruitment drive being able to take place because the working class kids coming to our gigs.
Jimmy Percy quickly found himself being the unwilling icon of a resurgent right wing.
Once the press had said, National Front, British movement, skinheads at this gig, it invited them all to come. So, of course, it's catch 22. I was damned if I did or damned if I didn't.
Jimmy Percy was trying to lessen the angst of what was happening to the white council house estate. You know, leaning out into the audience and talking to these kids and saying, you know, you don't have to become racist to handle what's going on. You know, there's another voice, there's another way of articulating this.
It was the most emotional period. Hells Angels, punks, whatever, do you understand? They were all around me, every different tribe was around me saying, Jimmy, where are we going? I'd never seen anything like it in my life before. I'd never felt that emotion.
Harder, rougher, and less art school than the first wave, it was arguably the second wave of punk bands that truly reflected the sound of Britain's troubled streets in 78. In Northern Ireland, groups like Stiff Little Fingers were tapping back into punk's revolutionary rhetoric. It's an alternative Ulster. Rabbit changing its shores. Get an alternative Ulster. Ignore the busted laws. Get an alternative Ulster. Be an anti-security force on the internet Ulster. I'll take your native land.
The reality of life was, it was just boring. Bands wouldn't come and play. They were either frightened to or, you know, nobody thought to invite them. The security forces at the time had a ring of gates and fences around the city centre which were locked and closed from about 6:30, 7 on in the evening.
A world away from the increasingly trendy London scene, this wasn't rebellion for its own sake. Punk in Northern Ireland made sense because kids had something very real to rebel against. You will never
be free. And it was all the kids from Leedside FS were going to concerts together and clubs.
There's something to talk to, and it was an identity for the kids and a good excuse for Catholics and Protestants to get together.
It was just this huge explosion, and everybody was playing at the same time. So, that, you know, from that point of view, it probably did bring the communities together, but it wasn't a conscious thing. It was just simply that, you know, people wanted to go see those bands. Alternative Ulster! Go and get it now!
But there was a growing sense by 1978 that punk's nihilism and attitude was becoming nothing more than a costume.
Is imitation the greatest form of flattery? Is it? Yeah, I ain't.
Punk had sort of outgrown itself within a year, I thought, really. I remember walking down the King's Road and seeing all these kind of stereotype punks with their sort of mad Mohicans and tartan kilts and all that caper, and I just doing photos with the American tourists, and I just thought, this ain't really what it's supposed to be about, surely. I heard your bill playing just the other night. They lost the bottle
single. The idea that you act wear your Nazi armbands and, you know, you follow the fashion. To me, punk was about rejecting fashion.
You tell me to go and look at the punk rock scene, which yes. I'm afraid I didn't know very much about.
There's a great piece of film of Derek Nimmo going into seditionaries to be kitted out as a punk rocker, which I think sums it up a little bit.
There was no escaping it. Punk was becoming as orthodox as the world it had set out to destroy. With anxiety.
oh, you wear those clothes, you know, and you drink snake bites and you vomit all over the place and you gob. And it was like, oh, God, you know, don't bring it down to this, to these rules.
I found it very disturbing, really, because the whole ethos of punk was that you did what you want. The media cliché became an accepted cliché. And you forget that, hey, just a minute, this isn't what we were doing. We were trying to get rid of all that.
Once something becomes easy to copy, then it loses its power.
In January of 1978, at the height of their popularity, the Sex Pistols pushed the self-destruct button.
Oh, yes, the last Sex Pistol gig in San Francisco. Yeah. Funny how these things just, you know, trip off the end of your tongue.
Ever get the feeling you've been cheated? Good night.
I meant it. I was so fed up with like, the idiocy of the management and the dissipation of the band.
For many, punk died the day the Pistols split up. But by pulling the plug, they neatly sidestepped a problem. Punk was everywhere. It had taken centre stage, and its oppositional stance was now unsustainable.
One of the great achievements of the punk movement was to blow away some cobwebs. It was a great kind of full stop. But you can't look at punk unless you understand that its nihilism and its anarchy was the seeds of its own destruction.
It was a feeling in the air that actually this is all kind of going downhill by the end of 79. It wasn't fun. I think if you're not having fun, you should stop.
The bands that remained faced a dilemma. If punk was no longer rallying against the status quo, then what should it do?
You only began to see light at the end of the tunnel when the Clash brought out London Calling, and it's like, ah, we're free. You can actually embrace all that the world's offering. And that was a milestone record because it broke the shackles of punk rock.
London calling through the faraway towns. Now war is declared and battle come down. London calling to the underworld. Come out of the cupboard, you boys and girls.
There was a feeling that punk music had really painted itself into this corner. We were like thinking along the lines of, well, it's about all music. We were just playing all the music that we liked.
And the crunch of thing, the ice is coming, the sun's zooming in, meltdown expected, the wheat is going thin, engine stuck on him, but I have no fear, cos London is drowning, I live by the river.
The Clash survived because within the language of the Clash is this desire for change.
But it wasn't just the Clash that were learning how to leave punk behind.
I first felt a fist, and then a kick. I could now smell their breath.
Things outstay their welcome, don't they? So we took from it what we wanted and what we thought was we could use. It took us a couple of albums to do that.
Some of punk's original class of 76 were even beginning to carve out careers as bona fide pop stars.
A lot of people that had served their apprenticeship in the punk rock era had learned a thing or two. And you know, I certainly did. I certainly became a pop singer. Punk was over. My intention was to just get this thing sounding, looking different from everything else around me.
Oh, and
it. My first reaction to Hong Kong Garden, when we first wrote it, I just thought, oh, it's too poppy. When I kind of thought about it, I thought, well, actually, you know, I love pop music. There are some curveballs within the realm of pop. So really, it's a perfect, you know, platform for anything, really.
We thought, let's use the radio, let's use the TV, let's use the newspapers. Certainly gave me a future.
In a little over 2 years, punk had both torn down the walls of the establishment and imploded. But how would the generation of bands that followed face the questions that had been thrown up post-punk?